Hello and good afternoon from Proactive New York. Andrew Allen, CEO at Gritstone Bio, joins me today. Andrew, good to meet you. How are you today?
I'm well, thank you. Sorry to be outside, but getting a bit of California sunshine at a hospital here, visiting some physicians working on our trials. So all good stuff.
Very interesting to hear. And it looks very nice over where you are right now. So Andrew, for investors who are new to the story here, give us a quick intro into Gritstone.
Sure. So Gritstone has a couple of technologies that lie at the heart of all of our programs. The first is that we've used some machine learning, elegant science to help us figure out within a target, whether it's a target cell or a virus that we're trying to immunize against, which bits of that target are the best targets for the immune system to lock onto and destroy. So that's a whole body of work. That's technology number one. Technology number two is then to deliver those targets to the human immune system using highly immunogenic vectors, meaning the kind of shell that you wrap these targets in. So if you think about COVID vaccines, you know, there are adenoviruses as a way of delivering the famous spike protein, or you can deliver it with mRNA. So that's referred to as the vector. And we have actually several, including a second generation, potentially best in class form of mRNA called self-amplifying mRNA. So those are the two core technologies that we have, the targets and then the delivery vector system. Off of those platforms, we have two different therapeutic portfolios. One is in cancer, and there we're focused on immunotherapy of cancer, which of course has become a big deal in recent years. But most patients with solid tumors still don't respond just to being given antibodies that activate the immune system. And the reason is that we think many patients have tumors that actually are quite clever and have hidden from the immune system. And if you give them non-specific immune stimulants, which is what the current set of antibodies do, you don't actually have substrate to work on, and essentially, therefore, they cannot really work. So we identify the abnormalities on the tumor cells, put them into our high-quality vectors or vaccines, and then give the patient a simple intramuscular vaccination, just like your COVID vaccine, that then generates T cells against those tumor cells. And what we've shown in our early clinical trials in advanced patients, patients with advanced disease, is that we can drive strong immune responses to these targets, and that can lead to apparent destruction of tumor cells in multiple subjects. And we're now in a randomized trial, so-called phase 2-3 study, where we're actually testing this against a control arm to really get definitive data. And we'll have early data for that big trial in the third quarter of 2023. So that's the fully personalized product. And then we have a slightly more facile off-the-shelf product that's in phase 1-2 trials still. And we'll have data off of that platform in the second half of this year. And there we're very focused on KRAS and mutant forms of KRAS, which, as you may know, is now a popular cancer target. So this is a novel approach to hitting this very attractive target on tumor cells. We had encouraging early data with a version 1 of this product, and we've now optimized it. And version 2 is in the clinic, and we'll have phase 2 data in the second half of this year. So that's cancer. Let's turn to infectious diseases. Obviously, as one can imagine, we can potentially protect people against infectious diseases. You can also maybe treat people with established infections. So our first move in this space was actually a partnership with Gilead that we signed at the beginning of 2021, where we take our products and we put HIV targets into our vaccines. And Gilead is using this now as part of an attempted therapeutic approach to patients with HIV infection. So this is not prevention, this is actual treatment. Gilead's running that, so that's kind of in their gift, as it were, and we don't tend to talk much about it. What we're focused more on currently is really establishing the power of this self-amplifying mRNA platform, which potentially has a couple of benefits over the first generation mRNA products that we're all familiar with, you know, the Moderna and the Pfizer-BioNTech products. Self-amplifying mRNA, as the name suggests, actually makes copies of itself. And that potentially drives these two benefits. Number one, we appear to be able to deliver the quality of the immune response similar to Moderna, which is the best in class product right now. But whereas Moderna needs 100 micrograms, we seem to achieve similar effects in terms of immune response with just 10 micrograms. So a tenfold reduction in administered dose. That, of course, may have many advantages, including cost of goods. The other potential benefit is that self-amplifying mRNA probably is a little bit more inflammatory to the immune system and potentially drives a stronger immune response in regard to killer T cells. And without going into too much detail, we know that natural immunity to virus infections, and this includes COVID-19, but also influenza and many other viruses, natural immunity actually relies on both antibodies and killer T cells, and they complement each other. Antibodies neutralize virus before it gets to cells, but once a virus goes inside a cell, it's invisible to antibodies. Then you need these killer T cells that can recognize virally infected cells. And that's that second component is one where the first generation mRNA products have modest activity, but potentially self-amplifying mRNA can drive a much stronger immune response to kill those infected cells. In other words, generate stronger killer T cells. We're generating those data as we speak. We showed a little bit of human data in January of this year, looked very encouraging. And we're basically running two big studies now. One is a boosting study that's being run in the UK, and the other is a CEPI-funded study in South Africa. And this is in vaccine-naive subjects. So pretty important to really put flesh on the bone, as it were, of this novel platform. And that study is moving along very nicely, giving two shots to vaccine-naive subjects using some interesting new types of targets within the vaccine. So we include spike, just like all the other vaccines, but also we have additional targets that are potentially very good targets for the killer T cells of the immune system. So that's work in South Africa, and we'll have clinical data off of both of these programs through the second half of this year. So a lot going on, two big therapeutic areas, data in the second half of this year, and then big data on the oncology side in Q3 of next year.
Right. Clearly so much going on. You have many different therapeutics in the pipeline here. You did report your first quarter financial results where we did see where we did see cash of around $186 million. Is that enough to take you through all of these programs?
Yeah, that gets us to Q3 of next year, Q3 of 2023. So obviously, we will need to raise more capital. And of course, nobody wants to issue shares at the current prices. And so our focus, of course, is on business development as a preferred source of capital. And you can imagine, particularly with the self-amplifying mRNA platform in infectious diseases, this is a hot space. We have a potentially best-in-class platform. Everybody, of course, wants to see human data just to really be confident that it delivers on promise. And we've demonstrated already in humans. In January, we put out some public data showing that this vaccine looked very good as a boost. And of course, more data to come in the second half of this year. So we're obviously optimistic about the potential for this platform and the possibility of using non-equity capital to further extend our runway and let us deliver on these programs.
And how significant is the licensing side of the business?
Yeah, so we've shown we can do this. Clearly, as I mentioned, we have the Gilead collaboration on HIV therapeutic vaccine. That was a $60 million upfront payment. And so, you know, these assets are clearly of interest and of value. So this is a meaningful work stream for us right now.
All right. And anything else investors should be keeping their eye on besides what you've mentioned so far?
No, I think the watch out for our data. If you want to take a look at the January data, there is a somewhat comparative data set because a large study was run in the UK boosting healthy volunteers who'd previously received a variety of different primary series vaccinations, so AstraZeneca or Moderna or BioNTech Pfizer. The study that we ran followed AstraZeneca as a primary series. And so these two, our data and that publication, are actually very analogous, run in very similar subjects, very similar timeframes. And the data for the antibodies are generated using a very standardized assay. So you can actually do some pretty good direct comparisons. And the comparisons look very favorable for our platform, as I mentioned, at a significantly lower dose. So very encouraging start, obviously more to come this year.
Definitely indeed. Andrew, good to meet you. Thanks so much. Appreciate it.
Thank you. Thanks for your time.